United States. We start this day with a keynote speech, and the keynote speech is given by Carsten Schanze from Volkswagen. And I'm very happy to have him as a speaker today, because I know him since several years, and I know that he has also some very good experience made with KNFD and with classical KN, and also is one of the initiators of the KNXL future. Carsten, I think you will provide us a lot of information which we have not been before, because you talk about the perspective of an OEM of the future of KN, but you also will give us a little bit background information what has been done so far. Please, Carsten, take the screen, not to say take the floor.
Thank you, Holger. So hello to everybody. So it's for me to say it the first time to have a keynote speech. So thank you for the opportunity. First of all, I will start with the content of my presentation. So the first thing I did is to ask my colleague, as Holger came to me with this idea of this keynote speech, and ask them what could they say if they talk about KN. And then I put some words here together. Then it seems I agreed my presentation also with yesterday's presentation of Holger and Magnus, because I'm also looking a little bit in the past, in the history, to then found some ideas what will bring the future. So after the history, I will show you the current status of the KN, and then I risk a forecast, but as you know, the first plannings of these conference was last year in March, and I prepared my presentation for this last year March, and now we are 1 year later, and a little bit the future overtook me. I will end my presentation with a conclusion. So first, what is the idea of a KN? So I asked my colleagues, so you know the three letters CAN. What does it mean? And there came, first of all, it came flexibility. So KN means flexibility. It's there is a scalability. So the my architecture colleague said, okay, this scalability is we had the possibility to have we can change the size of the network, the number of ECUs, for example, and also my colleagues from the technology said, okay, scalability for us means we can scale the bitrate versus topology, and also the layout of the control units we have in the cars. There's a lot of scalability and flexibility. Then the KN is very cost efficiency. So you know what it means. It's very interesting for us as OEM to have these robust and low cost network, and it works very, very fine. And then there's also at last the controllability of KN. So if I ask with a colleague of mine who's responsible for the data definition, said, okay, almost everybody is able to access and read the KN, and that's very great also if we look in our cars. Now I take the look in the past. So, and to do this, I will do this. I will look for one of our cars, the well-known Golf. The Golf is for Volkswagen, the carrier of new technologies. So if we introduce a new technology, like KNXL, Holger stated it before, it will be first in the Golf. So let's start with the Golf. The first Golf is established in 1974. Until today, more than 35 million Golfs are sold. So the first generation we put there, here we see, I found some architecture is from 1975, but you see no KN networking at all. So this is no big surprise. As Holger told us yesterday, the KN is established in 1986. So, in this case, in this year, no CAN networking at all. So, by the way, 1975 ends the war in Vietnam. So the second generation of Golf comes 1984. Okay, also before 1986, no CAN networking at all. In 1984, France wins the seventh European Soccer Championship. So compared with today, we have also today the 16th European Soccer Championship, and today there is a match, Germany versus France. So let's see. The third generation of Golf, 1992, no CAN networking at all. And in this year, Bill Clinton becomes the 47th president of the United States, only to know in which year we are. Now come to the fourth generation of the Golf. So in this kind, we found some networking, some CAN networking here. We have in total number 11 ECUs. We had a powertrain with 500 kilobit per second and a comfort network with 62.5 kilobits per second. And this comfort network is a so-called fault-tolerant network. 1998, Bill Clinton is in the headlines again, but it's not regarding Bill Clinton. It's because Monica Lewinsky. So now the fifth generation of Golf we had there in this year 2003. You see there we had more, the number of ECU increases. We had 31 ECUs and we had first time a central gateway. And we had one high speed network for the powertrain, 500 kilobits. It's the green one. And the other, both networks are for comfort and infotainment, is with 100 kilobit per second, and it's fault tolerant again. The sixth generation, it's very similar to the fifth generation. We had 27 ECUs. It was established in 2009. 2009 was the year of the global financial crisis, and also again, we had three networks here, maybe four if you count the subnetworks as a separate network, and one is high speed, and the fourth and two are fault tolerant. Then in the seventh generation, there's a big jump in number of ECUs. So we had here, in the year 2012, we had for the first time only high-speed CAN networking and 36 ECUs, again a central gateway. The eighth generation is the current generation of the Golf. In this case, we had 55 ECUs, a central gateway again, and we had four CAN-FD networks. So, and to be honest, I'm a little bit proud about this because I'm responsible for the development of CAN-FD in the Volkswagen Group. So the other eight high-speed CAN networks communicate with 500 kilobit again. So this was a short history of the Golf. And now I can, I try to found some conclusions about this history. So first of all, I tried to add all the bit rates of the Golf of each control unit. You see it in the left picture, and found it in the left picture. And so as something new in between, I add here also the first MEB, the battery car, the ID3 in this case. So if you sum all the NEDA and the bit rate of the ID3, you reach this point here. And also I sum up all the line lengths we had in our CAN networks, and I put it in this diagram here on the right side. So you see the increase of the bitrate and also of the line length gets higher every time. So it's an exponential curve in this case. So after this, I tried to think, so what will happen? Is there the possibility to find something for the future? And then for this, I plot the total line lengths according the netto bit rate. So, and then you found this diagram here. So you see here the bit rate and the line lengths, and if you extrapolate this, you see where it will end in the future with this decrease. So if you a calculation shows that if the bit rates gets to 65,000 kilobits per second, then when we will have an total line length of 200 meters. Okay, this is it could lead to problems, because this line length leads to higher writes and also challenges for the package of the ECUs. And also for me as physical layer expert, the total line length has an impact on the signal entropy D2. So larger networks forces technologies to improve the signal. So we know it, we heard yesterday the presentation of Magnus, and he told us about the SIC technology to improve the signal entropy. So now what we had in the past, so past means until today. So all our CAN networks are organized in functional domains. Bitrate and line lengths strongly increase since 2010. And as I said before, the increase of the total line lengths leads to higher weights, layout problems, and also with problems with the signal integrity. So what we see today, what trends we see today? So first we see that we see a so-called vertical shift. LIN ECUs are upgraded to 10. We have 100 base T1 communication. This communication sometimes replaces CAN communication. So maybe we have the communication between cameras and radar sensor in our driving assistance systems. This is they communicate today with 10 base T1 before they have communicated with CAN. We have also longer messages. So security reasons require sometimes the transfer of signatures. And to minimize the impact on the bus load of the signature, we merged some messages so that we had a better netto bit rate. So, okay, so one of these points forces us for the following requirements. So first of all, we had to clean up the wire harness. So to reduce the weight, and this will also reduces fuel consumptions. To gain space for the wire harness, we had to reduce the wire harness, and also to ensure the signal integrity, there are two possibilities. Also, that the wire harness do not increase anymore, or also, as I told you, there to introduce a new technology to improve the signal. So also we need a little bit more scalability. We need more bandwidth and also more data lengths. The visions of my colleagues from the architecture is to have one architecture for all our cars. Means all our cars in the whole Volkswagen group. So one architecture fits all. So one of the possible futures, I guess Zhang, you know it, is to go away from these domains and go to zonal architectures. So in this So this means the CAN networks will be organized in zones instead of functional domains. These maybe vehicle is divided in different zones. So as I it's an example I put here, so that we have these zones are in local areas. So these zones have an zonal gateway, and also these zonal gateways will be contacted with a backbone communication with a high performance computer somewhere in the center of the car. So if we look for this zonal architecture, so the zonal network is placed in a zonal gateway. So these zonal gateway communicates with the zonal networks. So this means this is the brain of the car. Then we had also the sensor and actor network. This is also part of the brain. So now I came to the CAN XL. So I put some arguments what we need. So and CAN XL offers a lot of this. So the CAN XL offers the possibility to transmit IP frames. So we can scale the bandwidth from today's communication with the classical CAN from 500 kilobit up to 10 megabit per second. We can combine CAN XL with every version of a transceiver. So means with a classical CAN transceiver, a CAN FD, a CAN FD-SIG, and also a CAN XL transceiver where we can use the full bandwidth. So now I tried to estimate the impact of new CAN communication technologies like CAN FD-SIG and CAN XL. So I took the same plot I have shown you before. You see it on the left side. And then I try to introduce these new technologies. You see here due to the fact that we had a higher bandwidth, we have a lower number of the total line lengths. So this is also it's due to the fact that we had a higher bandwidth in the different technologies. So we can use 5 megabit for CAN FD-SIG and also 10 megabit per second for CAN XL. So now I came to my conclusion. So this means we had the requirements for the CAN communication technologies in the future are first to clean up the wire harness, reduce the weight, gain space, and ensure signal integrity, to deliver more scalability, to satisfy bandwidth and data length requirements, and don't forget signal improvement. So in my opinion, these requirements will be solved in the future by changing from the domain-oriented architecture to zonal architectures and introducing CAN FD-SIG and CAN XL. So as I told you, so the future has a little bit overtaken me or this presentation. So our new cars that will come in the future are planned with zonal architectures and also planned with CAN FD-SIG and CAN XL. So this was my last slide. Thank you. And